So our last speaker is someone who used to do some very, very important roles in technical roles in the UK. And that was, you know, the people who choose the music that play on mainstream media, Radio 1, MTV, the people who do those jobs can sometimes get lost in the technical aspects of the role, the research, the software, and so on. It's a pretty awesome responsibility to be programming 9 channels of music television for Europe. But Chris Price, our next speaker, did those roles, but he did them differently, because Chris is a writer, a thinker, and a bit of a poet. I mean, I'm not sure whether you actually write poetry, but to me, I always thought that Chris had a very, very creative mindset when he was doing these roles. So I'd like you to welcome Chris, who's going to complete, if you like, the trio, and then we'll have our Q&A session. So please, could you welcome to the stage Chris Price.
Do we have the clicker thing anywhere?
I think I put it up there. It's just underneath.
Oh, well done. Brilliant. Thanks, Andy, for that very generous introduction. As Andy said, I've been editorializing music for various media for about 12 or 15 years, for radio, for TV, and recently for an online music discovery platform called Last FM. So I suppose I've been on the discovery end of music, popular music, for most of my career. By contrast, my qualifications to speak about music education are pretty limited, so I thought I'd give the first word to somebody who ought to know what he's talking about. This is the Education Secretary, Michael Gove, speaking on Question Time recently about creativity in music and language.
All right, Michael Gove. Creativity depends, as Anthony said, on making sure that you master certain skills, you acquire a body of knowledge, before then being able to give expression to what's in you. So if you're musically gifted, or you want to pursue creativity in the way in which you write, you need first of all to learn your skills. You need to be able to secure a foundation from which your creativity can flourish. In the same way, as Anthony said, if you're going to write, if you're going to move, if you're going to persuade, if you're going to inspire, then you need to be able to know how the English language, which is a wonderful instrument, can be used and tuned in order to move hearts, in order to persuade people. And you cannot be creative unless you understand how sentences are constructed, what words mean.
It's hard to know where to start with that, isn't it? I mean, there's a couple of things that stood out for me watching that, that line. You need, first of all, to learn your scales, and also that last line, you cannot be creative unless you understand how sentences are constructed, which in quite a strong field might be one of the most wrong-headed things that Michael Gove has ever said. Creativity isn't like learning to drive. Andy said it's not like medicine. There's no test you have to pass before you're allowed to be kind of let loose on the public. I stand before you as a self-taught guitarist on the one hand, and as a grammar school and university educated student of French on the other, and neither of which I plan on subjecting you to do today, by the way. So you'll just have to take my word for it when I tell you that I express myself a good deal more fluently and creatively, I think, on guitar than I do in French. I can't point to any hard data that proves that Michael Gove is wrong. It just doesn't resonate with my own experience. Here's another point of view from on exactly the same subject. From a virtuoso bass player and music educator called Victor Wooten, which absolutely does resonate.
Music is a language. Both music and verbal languages serve the same purpose. They are both forms of expression. They can be used as a way to communicate with others. They can be read and written. They can make you laugh or cry, think or question, and can speak to one or many. And both can definitely make you move. In some instances, music works better than the spoken word because it doesn't have to be understood to be effective. Although many musicians agree that music is a language, it is rarely treated as such. Many of us treat it as something that can only be learned by following a strict regimen under the tutelage of a skilled teacher. This approach has been followed for hundreds of years with proven success, but it takes a long time, too long. Think about the first language you learned as a child. More importantly, think about how you learned it. You were a baby when you first started speaking, and even though you spoke the language incorrectly, you were allowed to make mistakes, and the more mistakes you made, the more your parents smiled. Learning to speak was not something you were sent somewhere to do only a few times a week. And the majority of the people you spoke to were not beginners. They were already proficient speakers. Imagine your parents forcing you to only speak to other babies until you were good enough to speak to them. You'd probably be an adult before you could carry on a proper conversation. To use a musical term, as a baby, you were allowed to jam with professionals. A child speaks a language for years before they even learn the alphabet. Too many rules at the onset will actually slow them down. In my eyes, the approach to music should be the same. After all, music is a language too.
Isn't that amazing? Yes, definitely. I don't know about you, but I'm more persuaded by somebody who plays bass like that than by a politician. A couple of things that really stuck out for me watching this clip. The line, as a baby, you were allowed to jam with professionals. I think that's really powerful. And also that last line, music is a language too. Especially that one, actually, because the platform for self-expression that it offers is what, for me, makes music and music making such a transformative experience. So I just wanted to ask you to hold those two thoughts in your mind of young people jamming with professionals and music as a language while I just use the remainder of my time to try and persuade you of my central message today, which is that more than ever, young people are discovering, buying, listening to, sharing, and crucially making music digitally. I've called my presentation Disclosure Culture because it allows me to talk about two distinct but related phenomena over the last 5 to 10 years. The first is the apparently unstoppable rise of dance music, or EDM, electronic dance music, as it's more commonly known these days, as exemplified by two of the biggest albums this year, the first by Daft Punk's Random Access Memories, and also a debut album by a pair of despicably talented young brothers from Reigate named Disclosure. And the second phenomenon I want to talk about today is the culture of sharing, which is so prevalent among young people. Social media, as you know, has sort of transformed notions of privacy. And nowhere is that more visible than in the way that young people self-identify through music. So to start with dance music, a few weeks ago, Music Week published this headline. Dance music claims its highest UK market share since 2006. And it starts off by saying that dance music sales have seen a sharp increase in 2013 to give the genre its highest UK market share of 16% since 2006. And that dance music singles were up by nearly a fifth compared with the same period a year ago. And it goes on to point out a few interesting trends. The first is that Daft Punk's Get Lucky took just 69 days to pass 1 million sales in the UK. In April, Calvin Harris became the first artist in UK chart history to achieve 8 top 10 hits from the same album, overtaking Michael Jackson's previous record of 7. That dance debutantes continue their reign in the charts, where Disclosure's Settle swooped in at number 1 in June, and Rudimental's first studio album landed the top spot in May. And lastly, that demand is being fueled by fans who are increasingly digitally engaged. With nearly half downloading dance albums compared to 35% for albums overall. Now, if anyone's thinking, well, 16% market share on a few big dance albums is hardly an unstoppable rise, I want to argue that these figures massively understate the huge influence that dance music, electronic dance music, is having right across the spectrum, from pop to dance and even to rock. Just give you a few notable examples. This is what a pop record sounds like this year. Icona Pop, probably the biggest pop record of this year. I mean, that, you know, that fall to the floor rhythm comes straight from EDM. All of the imagery in that video is straight from club culture. Urban music is the same. If you've heard a Rihanna record in the last 18 months, you're basically listening to a dance record. Reggae is the same. This is a UK dancehall track that's been on Radio 1's A-list for a little while. It's a sneak bow ring-a-ling. Just listen to what happens about 15 seconds into this. So that euphoric build-up that you heard there is straight from house music. The kind of squelchy bass at the end is straight out of dubstep. Sorry about the wrong artist names, by the way. Here, I think PowerPoint has decided it doesn't like the artist name, so it's decided to change them. Even rock music isn't immune to this. This is Muse sounding more like Skrillex.
New energy cannot be created, and high-grade energy is being destroyed. An economy based on endless growth is unsustainable.
So dance music is king at the moment. To listen to the radio these days, you could be forgiven for thinking that all popular music at the moment is dance music. Lastly for this bit, I just wanted to give you a bit of a window into the new sort of the new language of electronic music making. One of the things that I do as a consultant is curate the music for a music industry trade magazine called Record of the Day. And a few months ago, I featured a track by Breach called Jack. It sounds like this.
I want your body, everybody wants your body, so let's check. Let's check. I want your body, everybody wants your body, so let's check. Come on, let's check.
Actually, the lyrics in the crazy video are about the least interesting thing about this track. It's a really, really odd record. It's very sparse. It's got this tension between the kind of crisp, urgent groove and then this sort of swollen, sluggish bass line. And I was just so intrigued by it when I first heard it that in a very slightly nerdy way, I just wanted to find out how it was made. So I did a little digging around on the internet, and this is Ben Westbeach, AKA Breach, telling us how it was done. I use Cubase as my main DAW, then I rewire Reason and Ableton through it and basically use them as samplers, which I go out into hardware, then back into Cubase. I love the NNXT in Reason and the ease of audio stretching and manipulating in Ableton. I use an Empirical Labs Fatso on my Beats Bus, and this is the key to the Breach sound. I won't read the whole thing, you get the idea. I'm sure we can all agree that an Empirical Labs Fatso is the obvious choice for your Beats Bus. But if there's any other terminology in there that's not completely self-evident, then maybe we have some catching up to do. So hopefully, having gone some way to persuading you that much of the music being consumed by young people today is electronic, I just wanted to present a few stats to demonstrate that you know, the discovery and the purchase and the sharing mechanism is digital too. There's lots of data on here, so I'll just pick out a few of the most salient facts. 51% of UK record labels record label revenues up to the end of quarter three last year came from digital. Actually, the final year-end tally just dipped below 50% with the Christmas gifting market, but this year is almost certainly going to be the year that the UK becomes a digital majority market for recorded music. 3.7 billion audio streams in the UK last year. That's a huge number. A billion playlists created on Spotify. These next two numbers are really interesting to me. 345 million tracks were downloaded using the peer-to-peer file sharing service BitTorrent alone in the first 6 months of last year, compared to 239 million tracks downloaded legally in the same time period. And lastly, 62 million tracks shared on Facebook, which brings me on to my next deployment of the word disclosure. We know that young people share a lot more than their parents do. A recent Pew Internet study in the US, this is, looked at how 12 to 17-year-olds' social media habits were changing over 5 years, and some of the main findings, it was a huge thing. I've just picked out three of the most interesting. Surprise nobody to find out that teens are sharing more information about themselves on Facebook than they did 5 years ago. 91% post a photo of themselves, up from 79% 5 years previously. 71% their school name, 53% their email address, and crucially for our purposes, 84% post their interests, like films and music and books. Teen Twitter use has grown significantly. 24% of online teens are using Twitter, and that's up from 16% just the year before, and public accounts are the norm. And lastly, teen social media users don't express a high level of concern, as many adults do, about third-party access to their data, with just 9% saying that they were very concerned. Self-expression through sharing takes place in a number of other ways. One of the more recent innovations in the world of social media is what they call frictionless sharing, which refers to app or platform settings which instantly and publicly share some aspect of your online activity to social media. Last.fm is a good example of this. This is my Last.fm profile, which is showing my recent listening. So I'm scrubbing my listening from iTunes and Spotify and any of 650 other devices and platforms so that it's shared publicly on my profile. Scroll down a bit and you can see a rundown of my most listened to artists recently. There's even a Facebook app that allows you to share every single song that you listen to your Facebook timeline, as long as you don't mind losing a few friends. Or some people prefer, as I do, to just auto-tweet my most listened to artists over the last week. Slow sharing is sort of the opposite of frictionless sharing. This is a website called This Is My Jam, where rather than sharing every aspect of your listening, you're restricted to one kind of earworm every week. And then there's just another, I just wanted to highlight a few other types of, I'm calling it self-expression. We've heard a lot of this stuff from Jen, actually. She's given us some great insight already, so I'll kind of whiz through it. But, you know, there's a number of other important ways in which young people self-identify through music on and offline, such as video blogging, music blogging, promoting gigs and festivals, DJing. So just to kind of highlight a few of the most notable examples, this is Dan Howell, one half of Dan and Phil. Dan and Phil are right at the forefront of a new breed of video bloggers who have massive followings on YouTube. His subscriber numbers are nearly 2 million. Compare that to Radio 1's subscriber numbers. Looking for a smile from Mr. Penkip in the second row there. So yeah, that's video blogging. Music blogging, this is a page called Noi from, it's on a website called This Is Fake DIY. We've heard about that from Jen. This is run by a 21-year-old named Jamie Milton. This Must Be Pop, which is a blog and a newsletter, and now a live event run by a young lady named Jessica Pinkett, who's just celebrated her 10th anniversary running This Must Be Pop. She's 25. And then lastly, the Underage Festival. This is run, founded by a guy called Sam Kilcoyne, who was 13 back in 2007 when he started promoting gigs for his underage friends. Not long after that, the festival was born, and this is it has a strict no over 18s policy, where young people kind of kick back and let loose in a safe but adult-free environment. So just to kind of wrap up, really, I just wanted to sort of return to the two thoughts that I asked you to hold in your head at the beginning of this. Firstly, Victor Wooten's idea that as a baby you were allowed to jam with professionals. I think this is already happening, especially in the digital space. You've got young acts like Disclosure topping the chart alongside dance behemoths like Daft Punk. You've got music bloggers like Jamie and Jessica jamming alongside established music journalists. You've got video bloggers like Dan and Phil outperforming mainstream media and reshaping it from within. And you've got young festival organisers like Sam Kilcoyne staging events that used to be the preserve of corporate promoters. So just to kind of sum up, I wanted to just return to this idea of music as a language and just highlight a few of these trends that might impact on the world of music education. We've seen that the language is radically changing with music technology and so forth. And like your own mother tongue, the one that you speak most fluently is the one that you learned outside the classroom. New forms of self-expression through music are emerging or becoming available to creative people at a younger and younger age. I said before that music is a transformative experience because it's a form of self-expression, but so is blogging about it, so is creating a playlist on Spotify, so is putting on a gig or DJing. You know, much has been made of this disconnect between the number of young people citing music as a passion, I think something like 80 or 90%, and the relatively low number of people, young people studying music at GCSE and A-level. And I just want to ask, is it really a disconnect? Is it actually a failure, or are we just sort of asking the wrong question? So with that in mind, I just want to encourage you to think of music and music making less as ends in themselves than as platforms for exploring other disciplines. Music technology is becoming much more important. We've seen that. And perhaps this will lead to a change in the dynamic between teachers and students. Ken Robinson, in his most recent TED Talk, says that the role of a teacher is just to facilitate the learning process, nothing more. Victor Wooten, in a section of the earlier clip, which sadly I had to edit out, says that many music teachers never find out what their students have to say. We only tell them what they are supposed to say. And to my mind, the digital age is one in which teachers probably have as much to learn from their students as their students do from them. Thanks for listening.